Hello everybody, and welcome to another hair-raising and exciting episode of Radiorama, where I show you how to work on radios, televisions, stereos, and other stuff from the 1920s through about the 1960s. I say that, but sometimes I'll work on stuff even later. And today, this is actually a set I bought from me. I usually don't buy sets for myself unless there's something interesting. And this is a 1951 Saba export model W51. Actually, it says on Radio Museum 1950 to 1951. It's interesting because the way it's constructed, as far as the type of tubes and everything, really reminds me of something more like from the 1930s. Which, if you think about it, might make sense because Germany was still recovering, after basically being bombed out. And so it could be that... Here comes the street sweeper. Okay, well, hold on just a minute. I got to stop this for a second. I don't think the street sweeper really swept anything. He just drove by here at 90 miles an hour. Anyway, I'm guessing that, Germany was probably still recovering. And so perhaps they didn't have all of the resources to put brand new content together. I could be totally blowing smoke out of my ass. And now someone started the leaf blower. It's just a noisy day today in this neighborhood. Anyhow, I was playing with it yesterday, and first thing I noticed when I got it was the voltage switcher. As soon as I tried to adjust it, I gently pulled back on it. I heard a snap, along with the sound of a tiny little C-clamp ring shooting across my garage, which means I'll never find it again. But it's not a big deal, because what I did is I took a look and saw that, it's probably hard to film this, there's a little piece of brass that goes across to one of these guys, and the center is one lead, and the other is the voltage selector. So I've got it set to 120. I've got my death wires running into my variac. This is, I assume, the on-off switch. The fuses were missing, and so I've got these clamped off. Let me make sure for sure. And I tried it yesterday, and I'm getting nothing. It's dead, completely dead. Bring it up all the way, 110 volts, and there's nothing at all. There's no tube filaments, and it's interesting because we have two fuses. We have one for tube filaments and the other for, I'm assuming, the stuff going into the power transformer. Well, obviously it's the other side of the transformer, not the 6-volt winding. Now, here's something that's interesting, and this is why I got this set. Damn it, I'm gonna have to stop filming for a minute. Sorry, guys. Anyway, as I was saying before the leaf blower went nuts, when it was sold from the factory, it says on the description in Radio Museum that it was FM ready, which means, and I'm just assuming here, that you bought it with AM and shortwave, but you could add FM later. And this little box here, this is the FM box, and I know it's because it says UKW, and I'm not sure how to say that in German, but basically it means FM. And indeed, even on the front here, it has a setting for FM. Let's see if I can get it to show here. Yeah, UKW. I think that also means record player. So I guess both settings could be, I'm not sure. I'm not sure why you'd have a record player symbol with FM. But then again, I've never seen this model before. Anyway, it's dead. There's no power. I can't get anything to light up on it. It could be any number of things, either this on-off switch is gunked up, or perhaps I don't have the fuse, whatever thing on the bobs hooked up correctly, or some of these transformers have a backup safety where if something goes haywire, there's a little fusible link inside or on the side, and it'll pop open. But there's nothing happening here. It's zilch. So I'm going to have to take it out and investigate to see what's going on here. Well, I kind of wanted to indicate how remarkably stupid I can sometimes be. I didn't realize it, but when I was trying to take this knob off to get the case or the chassis out, I realized this pulls out too. That could be the switch. In fact, when I took this off, let me get my flashlight so I can see what I'm doing. Where does that go? Where does that switch come from? Okay, that you see that yellow jacketed thing? That's going to the power transformer. So that must be the on and off switch. So let's try this again. This time I put fuses in there. And I've still got my jerry-rigged alligator clips, so I'm gonna turn on my Variac. And I've got their bottom removed so I can see these festoon lights here to see if they get anything. If I see any filament, they could be both blown, who knows. Bring it up to about 50%. I don't see any lights here per se, but that doesn't mean anything. Let me turn this, pull this other one out too. I'm not seeing anything. Let me get this CFL away. All right, let's bring it up a little more. Yeah, I'm still not seeing any filaments. Nothing. Still nothing down here either. All right, I guess I'll go for broke and bring it up the rest of the way. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Well, you know what? God damn it. Did I take stupid pills this morning? This is not pulled out. All right, now let's try this again. Jesus. All right, try this again. I'm sorry, folks. I just woke up on the wrong side of the bed, apparently. These festoon bulbs look like they're pretty dark. I'm up to 50% now. I don't see anything, but let's look up top side and see if we get any filament of any kind. It's kind of hard to see because these tubes are so dirty. It's not promising. Not promising at all. This thing appears to be dead, completely dead. It's a good thing I didn't pay that much money for it. I was the only bidder on this thing at $35. All right, so now I think it's time to start doing some real troubleshooting here. First thing I'm going to do is see if I have any B+ at all. I want to see if there's anything getting into the set. Well, I can confirm I'm getting zero, and I mean zero B+. This is the bottom of my electrolytic. The chassis is ground, so I measured ground and positive. And there is no B+. Likewise, there's no 6-volt filament anywhere. Curiously enough, though, I am getting measurements off of that fuse. I think it's time to take the chassis apart. We need to start doing some serious under-the-hood investigations here. This might be a quick video. I powered this up again, and no filaments. And I started hearing a little bit of a crackling noise about halfway up. Turned it off. Smelled what smells like crispy transformer. Now the only other option here is maybe there's a bad loose connection in there. This is not easy to get at. I think I'm gonna have to try to remove this front panel off and see if I can get to any of these leads, see if any of them have worked themselves loose. We'll see. Blah. Okay, so I'm gonna go pull the schematic because I'm kind of wondering about this here. One side of the fuse directly is connected to this capacitor. And you can see there's little melted bits of this capacitor. So that thing is probably shorted hard. And if that's the case, that's preventing anything from getting through the set. But that still doesn't explain my 6-volt filament situation. This other cap's just a grounding cap, but I'm gonna replace both of these. I'm gonna pull the schematic if there is one. Otherwise, my connections look like they're good here. The transformer does not look stressed out. I looked underneath it. Usually, if they've been screwed with real bad, they will have tar oozing out of the sides, and sometimes the metal itself will look pretty discolored. And plus, it'll sometimes have a unique smell. I think I was smelling the tar incinerating in that cap. So I'm gonna go pull the schematic, take a look. Okay, so I printed the schematic. And it's interesting. You don't see this expressed very often. This is expressed in nanofarads. Usually it's picofarads and microfarads. I don't see nanofarads that much, but we got 5 nanofarads. Convert that over, that equals 0.005 microfarads. There's 2 of these guys, and indeed they are kind of in the way. If there's any shorting going on here, that can kill everything downstream. So I'm going to replace both of those guys. Because once they go into the rectifier, then that of course goes to your B plus rail there. So if there's a short in this area, that's going to really fuck things up. And I'm sorry I cursed. A lot of people have told me, quit doing that. It's not good. Anyway, let's replace these guys. And if this doesn't work, then I'm not sure. This might be a $35 mistake. All right, well, I kind of made an interesting discovery when I was replacing these, which is there's 4.005 microfarad caps, and the way they've done it is they put 2 in each one of these tubes here. Both of these are like this. The ends are boiled out. The foil is exposed, so this is just dead shorted. And one goes to the filaments and the other goes to the rectifier. So with both of those completely hosed, that could be the solution here. And replacing these was not easy. I had to go in here with some surgical pliers. So that's as far as I can pull that out. And I had to just snake the stuff in. I need to attach this one last connection to ground. Because in order to get this completely apart, I would have had to take the bell housing apart, which is not going to happen. So fingers crossed, I'm going to solder that last bit in there, and then we'll bring it up on the variac and see if that brings any more life to it. All right, let's try this again. So I've got everything wired up here. And I'm just going to bring it up about 50%. I'm not sure if I'm going to be able to see the filament on this rectifier. It's got some pretty fat filaments in there. Let me look under, see if I see those festoon bulbs glowing. I don't. I'll bring it up about 70%. A little bit more. What?
Riverside, California, 92514.
Are you kidding me?
Call 1-800.
No way.
1-800-821-3300. That's 1-800-821-3300.
I cannot believe that.
Mayoría no voy a decir de todas, pero de la mayoría de las familias.
That tube just no filament whatsoever. I mean, maybe it's just hidden in there. I don't know. So, let me try UKW, which is FM. I don't see any filament on those guys. I do see filament, actually. Let's see, I think I just turned FM on. I've got no antenna to FM. Let's see. I don't feel super comfortable reaching in there with this thing turned on. Let me turn it off and see if I can connect the FM antenna. Okay. Here's the other thing is that the cord for FM is snapped here. Looks like we've got tube filaments on these guys. I don't hear anything. Yeah, those are definitely hot. I don't know if I can test these guys either. These are rimlock tubes and I don't have the tester to do it. But you know what the good news is that it does seem to have some life now versus before where it had nothing. Oh, never mind. I disconnected the AM antenna. Anyway, I'm going to cut it off. I really don't want to run it with all those original capacitors in there. So this is a good start. So now that we confirm the radio is going to work, I'm going to go ahead and start the recapping job. And I'm going to start with these electrolytics. And see here, this one says 16 microfarads. And what does this other one say? 16 microfarads. Let me look at the schematic because I was certain. What'd I do with it? I thought it said 50 microfarad caps in there. 50 and 50. It's odd. That doesn't agree with the schematic. Let me flip it over here. And by the way, I took these, the rectifier and the output tube out so I don't smash them. The other thing I'm disappointed to see is that this guy, this tube's gone to air on the FM chassis and it's dead. It's an EQ80. Of course, I don't have any of those. I'll check at the museum tomorrow, see if we have any. But let's look underneath here. That's the only electrolytics in the set. So I'm just going to have to go with what's in the set, which is 216 microfarads, not 50 microfarads. Maybe I downloaded the wrong schematic. I doubt it. Anyway. There's quite a few capacitors in this thing. You've got all these guys that are black. They are paper caps, basically. It looks like most of these have their values written on them. This says 0.1 or a tenth of a microfarad rated at 600 volts. And so most of these I'm probably just going to be able to read what it says directly and replace like with like. I'm going to test these festoon bulbs to see if they're bad. I think they are. Might have to replace those with regular 6-volt bulbs. I don't know what this is all about. We have a line that's supposed to go somewhere, and where is it coming from? That's strange. I'm wondering if that's my FM antenna. Who knows? I'll have to do a little more look on the schematic. Okay, well, this set continues to show what a pain in the butt it is. I had to move that to replace that electrolytic because it was underneath all that. So I've replaced the two electrolytics and I've started doing the recap. I'm not sure if I'm going to recap the whole thing. This is my set, and I'll definitely replace the critical ones like the coupling caps and the output stage. Don't know about the rest of these. I'll probably do it anyway. But we got a lot of weird capacitors where we've got two and one. Like this says, 2 × 10 of a microfarad. And we can see we have two lines here, and then they're sharing a common ground there. So when you make sure when you see something like that you understand what you're replacing. Because to someone else that might not be as familiar, they might think that's one cap. It's not, it's two. Got a lot of those guys in this set, so I'm just going to be wary. The other thing I'm a little bit aggravated about is my schematic here does not really seem to be indicating where I would inject. Oh, wait a minute. Here's the FM. This is hard to read. The FM circuit and where it plugs into. Because see, this is, I believe that's the input from FM. It's a shielded cable and it goes all the way here and up into the unit itself. I'm trying to read this. This is obviously ground, ground, ground. And then we have a line. Where is it? A line here. This is hard to read. Looks like one goes to the filament. Well, obviously it's the filament. I know I got filament on the tubes, so that's good. So the only one I'm missing is the signal, and that is going, let's see here, and plugs into, I can't tell what that's doing. That little dot's just hanging out there. But it looks like, if I'm understanding this correctly, this would be going into the EBF-11 and pin number 5 and 6. I hope I'm reading that right, because again, it's weird that it terminates with this little dot there. Where? I'm losing my place here. It's weird that it terminates with this little dots that's just hanging out there in space. Doesn't make any sense. Okay, so I think I solved the easy issue here. I remembered seeing the record player symbol next to the UKW symbol on the front, and I thought, well, maybe they share the same connection. And as it turns out, I looked up this word translated to English. This means connection, and then UKW for, I'm assuming that means four. So connection for FM is the bottom connector, which is this guy right here. And that, well, there's a cap on one side, and this goes I believe that is the on off for FM. So that would make sense. And what's on the bottom of this cap? Where does that go? That feeds into, aha, that feeds into the wafer switch, the band switch. And that makes sense, because I remember seeing a switch, a series of switches here. Because here we have A minus coming out of FM. There's our wafer switches there. So just for giggles, because I'm curious if this, I know that tube was gassy, but I'm curious if I get any sort of noise out of this, if I connect that back to where it's supposed to go. Well, I got a noise, some static when it first fired up, which indicates, I think, that I've successfully connected FM again. But again, this tube just has no filament. It's not going to work without this thing. But in the meantime, this is the strangest tone control mechanism I've ever seen. Look at this thing. That is really creative. Anyway, I'll demonstrate how it works. The switch is really dirty on this, by the way. Okay, turn up. See, listen, watch this.
Hey there, friends. I'm reading this article on the Washington Post.
Very strange. You got essentially like two different settings for tone. God, I love weird engineering like that. Anyway, so FM doesn't work, but no biggie. I know that it's connected properly. And what I'm going to do now, because this looks like a hell of a nice speaker, I'm going to run an audio line in through the audio line input. Let's see what it sounds like. Good morning. So I'm over at the radio museum that I volunteer at, and I was on the phone with one of the guys last night, and I should have known this. The EQ80 tube that is bad in my set is the equivalent of 6BE7. which is an American type. And I looked through all of our drawers that have this type in it, 6BE6, and there's no 6BE7 here in all those, and there's no European tubes that we have of that kind either. I'm gonna have to order it. Apparently it's not a common tube, and I looked up in the tube manual, there's zero substitutions, so I don't think I've ordered a tube in years. This is such an unusual tube. All right, well, I did test the tube in question on this tube tester, and I can confirm it's hosed. Look at this. It's pretty purple glow. That means it's completely gas. Not happy at all. No shorts, but again, woo, look at that. It's firecrackers. Anyway, FM's not going to work. And in the meantime, I'm going to start recapping the chassis. I'm doing this before the other guys get here because they're kind of loud. Especially you, Jimmy, who I know is watching. So I want to get some stuff done on this before the guys arrive. Well, I got more of the recapping job done, and I'm about to head home. And I'll show you guys what that looks like when I get home, but I wanted to show this off. We are setting up a functioning teletype machine here. Now, this is the dumb terminal. And downstairs, we have the sender unit. But we've already been doing some test runs with it. I'll have to show that off at some point once we get it installed. Anyway, I'm going to go back to the house, and we will resume with the recapping job on the big Saba. All right, so I'm back home, and here's some of the work I did today. I just replaced a lot of capacitors. This is not an easy to work on set. There's just stuff just buried down in here in the layers. I've still got a few caps to replace, but the good news is that AM works, and my audio input, which is here, that's working too. What I've done here is I've got, and I need to clean this up a little bit, but I've got my right and left channels of my incoming audio line fused together through a pair of 100 ohm resistors, and that's going to my positive input along with the FM input, and then that goes directly to the volume pot. So now if I want to listen to AM or FM, I can also listen to music too. Now the next thing I'm going to do is work on the cabinet, because it's pretty rough and I hate cabinet work. I'm like the last person on earth that wants to do this stuff. But I've noticed that the front here, this area is probably salvageable, but the entire top and sides are not good. So what I'm going to try to do is just sand all this finish off, and I'll refinish that, and I'll leave the front intact because I think I can save that. This is pretty thick finish. It's probably not going to be easy to get off. What I might do is try taping off this area here with masking tape so I don't accidentally sand through and into the finish on that bezel there. Some of you furniture guys are probably looking at me like an idiot. I've already removed the front that had the grill cloth out because I didn't want to damage that while I was sanding and refinishing either. All right, well, I've had a kind of a change of plan here. Started sanding on it with the old orbital sander, and I realized the finish that's left on there is real thick. Like, it's not coming off very easily. So I hate to do this, but I'm just gonna strip the whole damn thing. I've got it out of here in the shade, and I got some paper towels, and I think what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put a bunch of this stripper on there and put some wet paper towels in there to keep it from drying out. And then hopefully I can just hose the old finish off. God, I hate refinishing stuff. Like, if I could just somehow wave a magical wand and it became refinished for me, that'd be great. But anyway, it is what it is. Well, I couldn't quite figure out how to use the paper towels, but anyway, this stuff's all glopped on there. It's kind of gross looking. Looks like snot. It says it works in about 30 minutes, but I'll probably let it work even longer. I'll see if the stuff will just either scrape or hose off.
We're doing some exciting things. Like, my brother is filming me, like, doing this. So what I did is, like, I put a lot of, basically, a stripper on the cabinet. And I've been, like, spending probably 3 or 4 hours just like getting this goo into the surface and scraping it off. I, like, eventually I will like spray this stuff. It's really bad.
All right, well, this is the results after many layers of stripper. And as you saw, I soaked the crap out of it with the garden hose, and I really couldn't see what I was doing as easily because it was late, but most of it came off. And so what I'm going to do is just apply one more application in these areas where the finish is still stubbornly attached. And when I went to the store and I got some stain and some finish and a sanding sponge, even this cute little kitchen brush, because I need to get in and be able to, you know, scrub that stuff out of there. So, like I said, I hate refinishing stuff with a passion. All right, so returning to the chassis, I'm going to begrudgingly replace the last of the little capacitors, and some of these are just really buried in there. I need to rebuild the little FM unit up here too. These electrolytics, when I was powering it up, it was making this strange noise, like eee! And meanwhile, these were getting kind of warm. So I'm going to replace those two guys, and I probably need to pop this guy open, see if there's any caps inside. I kind of doubt there is, though. It seems like they mounted all the caps to the top. And then I'll do some general cleaning up, clean the glass, and lubricate and oil all this stuff up. Even though it's actually moving pretty well. I also found some festoon bulbs at the museum yesterday, so I got two new festoon bulbs. It's amazing. And like I said, I'm waiting for the cabinet for the goo and the stripper to do its thing so I can clean that up, sand it down, get it ready for stain and finish. Okay, so I took the bottom off of the FM module, and it appears not really anything to replace in here except for one cap. The rest of these are all ceramics and probably high precision, which is what you want when you have FM, which is very sensitive. I wanted to show you guys this too. This is crazy. You got a very delicate little glass rod that goes up and down through this coil form here. So it's slug tuning, basically. And unfortunately, I've noticed a very delicate wire that probably attached here or somewhere else has come loose entirely. So I'm assuming it works in tandem with that pulley back there. And there's no documentation online that I can find about how this FM module is attached, probably because not a ton of people got it. But I mean, it's got to be a situation where somehow I'd have to judge how far this pulley travels to determine how that line might attach. I wonder if it attaches here. No, it doesn't. I'll have to figure it out. Otherwise, the only way to tune this thing is going to be manually pushing that up and down, which is not going to work because it's spring-loaded. So I'll replace this last little cap in there, and I already replaced these two electrolytics there. So I'll do that, and then I'm going to go pay more attention to the cabinet. It's probably about ready to get the rest of the residue off. All right, I'm doing a test of the set now that it's fully overhauled, electrically anyway.
After that powerful magnitude 7.2 earthquake yesterday, the disaster adding to the plight of Haitians already struggling with the coronavirus.
Just a little bit. Mark. Seems to be pretty sensitive. I don't even have a very good antenna on this thing at right this point.
Fled the city.
Not bad. I imagine if I put an antenna on it, it'd be even better. I got to show you something that's kind of funny, though. I was trying to figure out what this thing was. turns out it's tone. It's the tone control. You can kind of hear how that gets like brighter and more bass, more treble. I'm not hearing any more popping and crackling away, so I think that I must have had a bunch of bad caps in this thing. Seems to be working pretty well. So now that I've turned that off, I'm going to go over and see what's happening with the cabinet. I'm not sure why I needed to tell you that I shut it off, but whatever. Anyway, this I think it's just about ready for me to scrub this off of there. And then I can let the surface dry, and then I'll give it a sanding. Okay, so I've succeeded in removing all of the old finish, and I'm going to have to make a decision here. Because, you know, without any stain on it, it's kind of an attractive color. It's kind of like this nice red color. I think it was probably pretty dark from the factory, but that doesn't mean you have to make it absolutely factory original. It's up to you. Like, if you like the way that something looks and it's your radio, it's your call. But this thing needs to sit out here and dry. And luckily it's a good, hot, dry, sunny day. So in a couple hours I'll be able to come out here and start sanding on it to smooth it down. Okay, it's do or die time. I've sanded down this case. Had to do some re-gluing. I had some stuff coming loose probably because I got it so wet. This whole front end was coming off, so I had to clamp and glue it. And likewise, I re-glued some of the interior pieces. And so now, I'm going to get my finish and put my first light coat on. The first coat's probably just going to saturate right into the wood, which is fine. We'll do a sand down of that first finish, then we'll put a second and probably a third coat on. Okay, so this is after the first coat. And I feel pretty good about my decision not to stain it. I think the natural wood color on this is really nice. And considering, you know, the blonde colored grill fabric and the black dial, I think that'll be a nice contrast. It looks like I did a decent job of sanding because I don't see any raised areas, even though this is just the first coat and it just soaked into the wood. The second coat will start to build a surface. Welcome to the final day of me working on the big Saba. And yesterday I put my second coat of finish on it and it turned out pretty good, I think. So now it's time to do reassembly. I'm going to put the speaker panel back in, then put the speaker in, slide the chassis in, put the knobs back on, give it a test. And I did order the tube that I need. It's coming from Europe, so it's going to be possibly a few weeks before it gets here. So I'm just going to go ahead and finish this up. And when that tube comes in, maybe I'll do a miniature episode showing me fixing the FM. But I think for now, I'm just going to reassemble and call it done for now. So first thing first, I need to put this panel back in. And then the speaker attaches to the back here. I've kept all the nuts on there. I cleaned up the speaker even though no one's going to see it. It's all nice and squeaky clean looking. And I cleaned the knobs. I even cleaned the felts on them yesterday as well. And so I'm hoping when I get it back together again, it's going to look like almost a new radio. Well, it's finally done. Mostly. Just need to get that FM tube. And it seems like it. Again, I think I made the right decision on that finish. I think it looks kind of nice, this kind of honey blonde flavoring going on. Right now, I've got it set on the record player input, so I'm running my audio through. Anyway, here's the. I haven't put the back on yet. Make everything hazy. That's not a very good filming job, sorry. Likewise, if I want to listen to the radio, just a little knob on the back here.
Who now would rather be an anywhere but homebody after spending 12 months stuck at home with nobody but themselves? Well, Motel 6 has plenty of clean, comfortable rooms, all at a great low rate. So when you decide to visit somebody...
Aren't we all? Put it back to audio input.
What did I do to you?
And here's our tone controls. Anyway, this radio is certainly a challenge. I wasn't sure if I was going to be able to pull this one off. I thought I'd instead bought a $35 big paperweight, but it came around, and I haven't decided whether or not I'm going to keep this one or not. I have a lot of Sabas. I probably have like 8 at this point, and I have another big radio that I bought. I've been on a radio buying splurge lately for some reason. So anyway, hope you guys got a kick out of this video and maybe learned a thing or two. And as always, if you have questions or comments, you can leave them down in the comment section down below. And if you like this station, make sure and hit that subscribe button. The more the merrier. I do try to respond to the comments if I can, if I have time. And again, I'm sorry about the low volume issue with this. I cannot adjust the microphone on my phone. I'm going to be buying a new phone in October, and I'm hoping that's going to solve the problem. I can work on antique electronics, but I'm a dunce when it comes to modern technology. Anyway, guys, till the next radio comes across the bench, see you next time.